Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Welcome to our online Easter worship service at the United Methodist Church of Geneva. I'm Pastor Rich Darr, and I am so pleased that you have chosen to be with us to worship the risen Christ today. A day we celebrate the fact that hope, life, and love conquer all. Indeed, Easter, hope, life, and love are all around. Please join us in singing Christ the Lord is risen today.
Happy Easter! This is Pastor Esther with the children's message for today. So, I wanted to see if you all can think about what you have in your house that reminds you of Easter. What do you think about when you think Easter? Well, I found a basket and I have a couple things to share with you that I have found in my house that reminds me of Easter. Well, of course, the basket reminds me of Easter because we sometimes get Easter baskets. Then we think about the bunny, right? The bunny. And sometimes we like to wear bunny ears like this. This is Brielle's and I'm gonna wear it today. And we think about the candies, right? Got some candies right here for Easter. And of course, the egg right here. We think about the egg. We color them, we paint them, we put stickers on them, and then we hide them and we find them. So egg reminds us of Easter. But how about other things that remind us of Easter? Do you know what things that we can think about when we think about Easter? I think about an angel. Do you guys have an angel at home? Maybe you could try to look for an angel in your house. I also have a cross with nothing on it. Sometimes we see a cross with someone on there, right, for our Catholic friends, but we have crosses that don't have anything, and this reminds me of Easter. Another thing that reminds me of Easter is cloth or sheets. White sheet that's folded neatly. I folded this at home after I washed it. Okay, we think about Easter when we have a sheet. And this reminds me of Easter. This, you ask, is a box. It's a box with nothing in it. It's empty. So why does this box that's empty, this sheet that's folded, the angel, and an empty cross have to do with Easter? Well, I'm going to read you something from this little book that I found. I read this to my kids, so I'm going to read this to you. It says, Jesus is alive again. Early in the morning on the third day after Jesus died, two women, both named Mary, went to see the grave where Jesus was buried. But when they arrived, the soldiers were not there. And they saw that the big stone in front of the entrance had been rolled away. A man in shining clothes suddenly stood by them. The angel said, "Don't be afraid. Jesus is no longer dead. He is alive again. He is risen." Look at that picture. He is risen. After the other disciples saw the empty tomb is empty and returned home, Mary turned around and saw a man. "Perhaps it is the gardener," Mary thought. But really, the man was Jesus. Mary suddenly recognized it was Jesus when he said her name. She knew that he truly was alive again. "Mary, go and tell the others that I am alive." Mary was so full of joy. It was the most wonderful moment in her life. Jesus had been dead, but now was alive. She could not wait to tell the news to Jesus' friends. Mary hurried to tell the others that she had seen the risen Lord. And that's from the Bible, in the book of Matthew and the book of John. Will you join me in prayer? You could follow after me. Dear God, thank you for raising Jesus from the dead, so that I can be with you one day. Amen. This is Jesus and Mary holding hands. So we learned that Easter is about the angel that visited Mary at the tomb, the cross that is empty and no one's hanging on it anymore, then the folded sheet where Jesus was all bound up. Now it's not binding Jesus anymore because Jesus is alive. And an empty, empty tomb of Jesus. So happy Easter, everyone. As a community of faith, we go to the source of our comfort and peace, healing and wholeness, our Lord Jesus, who has risen for us. As we acknowledge that God hears our prayers said aloud and in silence, written and extemporaneous, I will lead us in a prayer shared on the reworshipblog.com and adapted for our circumstance today. Please join me in an attitude of prayer. O God, with faces touched by the light of a new day and hearts warmed by prayers and praises, we come before you to pray for the needs of our world. Into the light of Easter morning, we raise those who are suffering, struggling with illness, with despair over their lives, or with the breakdown of relationships. We pray for our brothers and sisters listed in our recent prayer concerns list. Marilyn, Polly, Emily, Dick, Jim, Sandy, Micah, Rich, and many others with ongoing concerns. We also pray for the many caregivers who are caring for their loved ones at home during this time. May the light of the risen Christ shine upon them. Into the light of Easter morning, we bring to you in prayer those places in our world where war, violence, poverty, and needs are experienced every day, places near and far. We especially pray for your light to shine in these dark times we face in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic. From all who suffer, to all leading in this time all around the world. From many who work in the front lines, medical personnel and caretakers, to those needing to work to provide essentials to all of us. From those who lost jobs and financial securities, to the many business owners who find themselves in fear for their well-being and the well-being of their employees. We pray for the many incarcerated, as well as those bound up in broken systems, for families separated, and others facing hunger for food and justice, on top of the fear that we have in common today. We name in prayer the concerns for the teachers needing to teach differently, to the students who have to learn differently, and all of us who experience the loss of freedom and livelihood, all who live in fear and experiencing despair, all of us who hope and pray for a cure and continue to hold on to your promised deliverance and wholeness, the Shalom. We also lift up in prayer the disconcerting growth of hostility and violence, the expressed hate and misplacing of frustration upon people in recent days, especially the Asian communities. Lord, increase our sense of gratitude for all that we have now and expand our desire to love one another. May the light of the risen Christ shine upon all these concerns and shine in us. Into the light of Easter morning, we bring our prayers for the protection and strength of our brothers and sisters who serve in the armed forces and those who respond first to dangers and chaos today, as well as for peace upon their family and friends who wait upon them daily for their safe return home. We pray for the ministries that continue through UMCG now, as well as the justice for our neighbors
and the Tri-Cities Family Services. Today, we also pray for the Appalachia Service Project, the teams and their families who committed to this year's missions trip that is being canceled, affected by the pandemic. May all these missions organizations, their volunteers, and the people they serve be strengthened and be provided for. Help us also to work with them diligently until the day that these services and ministries are not needed anymore, and that we would see this day. May the light of Christ shine upon them. In the light of Easter morning, we bring our wider church, the United Methodist Church, our annual conference and staff, our district, and our church, UMCG. May the light of Christ shine upon us. And into the light of Easter morning, we bring ourselves, the private struggles, the heart's yearnings, the hidden dreams, the unfulfilled potential. May we walk our lives with zeal as we meet the risen Christ again today in our homes and within our hearts, just as the women and the first disciples who met the risen Savior did on that first Easter morning. May we shine the light of Christ wherever we are, whoever we connect with, in the days and weeks ahead. May we truly live as the Easter people. We pray all this in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, who also taught us to pray together aloud his prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Shine. Our gospel reading today is Luke 24, verses 13 through 35. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that had taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on, but they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God."
I love this story of the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. You know, it was probably late afternoon after the women disciples had witnessed the empty tomb in the morning and had shared their experience with the other disciples. You know, if you think about it, today's story unfolds in two settings: a journey on a road and a meal in someone's home. Actually, both have been common settings as Luke's story of Jesus has unfolded. Early in Luke's gospel, the disciples are depicted as setting off on a journey of faith. From the day Jesus first called them to the day he commissioned them to be his witnesses after his resurrection. Nearly two-thirds of Luke's gospel is devoted to the journey of Jesus and his disciples from Galilee in the north to Jerusalem in the south. Now, as for meal scenes, Luke dishes up far more meals than any other gospel. And these meals serve as settings where people experience Jesus' power to heal, forgive, and show compassion. Indeed, it is on the road and in the sequence of meals that Jesus' true identity is gradually revealed as Luke tells his story, culminating in today's Easter story. Today, Easter, we find ourselves in step with Jesus on a journey that leads us not only to Jesus himself, but to his church as well. Now, it's important to know that Luke's gospel was written sometime most likely between 80 and 90 CE of the Common Era. In other words, and this is important, 50 to 60 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. So Luke's story operates on several levels. On one level, it offers Luke's perspective on the earthly Jesus, his life, his teachings, death and resurrection. But on another level, Luke's story addresses the situation of Jesus' disciples, the early church at the time that Luke wrote this gospel. So remember, Luke is addressing the needs of the faith community of Jesus' followers some 50 to 60 years after the resurrection. But what were some of the early church's needs in 80 to 90 CE? Well, for starters, the church had only recently broken free from its mother religion, Rabbinic Judaism. As with any fledgling movement, the church to whom Luke wrote needed to know who they were. As a new faith community, they also needed to know how they were to worship. The Road to Emmaus story helps them answer the question of identity. Who are we? As well as the question of liturgy. How are we to worship? Now, metaphorically, today's story answers the question of identity by asserting that the new religious community following Jesus is a pilgrim community. In other words, the church then and now is a pilgrim church, always on the road, always moving, always in step with its Lord. In short, they were, and we are to be, a living, active, dynamic movement, not a staid, inactive, half-dead institution. The church, back then and now, is a pilgrim people. Followers of Jesus meet him, encounter him, not only along the way, but whenever two or three gather in his name to hear the gospel read and the gospel preached, who share a sacred meal, Holy Communion, and who are then sent out to witness to their experience of the risen Christ. That is who the church was, and that is our identity, who we are today. Now, I don't know about you, but I can certainly identify with those two disciples in today's story as we're still in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic. There are times when I have the urge to escape, to flee, to find some safe place, my own Emmaus, away from the relentless news cycle and the recurring scenes on TV. Like those two disciples, I find myself bouncing in and out of fear and sometimes bewilderment. Now, what's just happened? Life isn't supposed to go this way, is it? I ask not only why, God, but where are you, Lord, in the midst of our current difficulties? And like those two disciples on the road to Emmaus, I think many of us are trying to make sense of our experiences, the experience of the pandemic. How to accept the unacceptable, the unthinkable. I must confess that I too, like Cleopas and his friend, I am not always quick to recognize Jesus walking beside me, walking with me, present in my life. How about you? Truth be told, even in so-called normal times, it can be hard to recognize Jesus walking alongside us. You know, life has so many distractions. The daily grind at work, raising our children, caring for elderly parents, bouts of sickness, and various types of loss. And when we are ground down and worn out, we tend to carry on mechanically, unable to lift our eyes or our minds from the dust of the earthly road we are traveling. So we become spiritually blind, unaware of God's presence with us. But the fact is, Jesus is still here. He's the unseen stranger walking with us, listening to us, and if we are willing to listen to him, He reveals himself to us. As those two disciples spoke of the cross, Jesus addressed their bewilderment and sorrow and filled their hearts with courage and hope as he pointed them to God's self-revelation found in the scriptures. Luke informs us that, and I quote, "Beginning with Moses and all the prophets, Jesus explained to them what scripture said about himself." What a powerful Bible study. I wish I would have been there for that. Well, when the trio finally arrived at Emmaus, the disciples still had not recognized the risen Lord. But he had won them over, and when invited, he quickly accepted their invitation to dinner. A simple meal was no doubt placed on the table. Bread was there. And now was the time for Jesus, the risen Christ, to reveal himself to them. How did he do it? You'll recognize these words. He took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to them. Those words, as you know, are spoken every time we celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. And as he broke the bread, they saw his hands, his nail-pierced hands, and instantly they recognized him, and instantly he was gone. Now, this Easter road story, the story of the road to Emmaus, is a symbol. It is symbolic of our lives. It's a story about us, a story about rolling out of bed each morning, having to face life again, having to deal with the coronavirus again, sheltering in place again, adjusting to our kids at home and for many of us working from home, facing life with all its joys and sorrows. It's about us, our lives, yours and mine. And it's a story about meeting the risen Christ. Where? In the person of others, oftentimes a stranger who travel life's road with us. When we encounter the risen Christ, we do so in reading scripture on our own, devotionally, as we study the Bible together with others in small groups, as we meet in small group discussions and support groups, and when we hear the gospel read and preached in worship. In those instances, we experience the risen Christ. And we also experience the risen Christ as we gather around our tables at home. And hopefully in the not too distant future when we gather around the Lord's table face to face for Holy Communion. May we today and in the days ahead be like those two disciples on the road to Emmaus. May we give Jesus opportunities to talk to us. May we give him the chance to open our ears so that we can hear what he has to say. May we give him the chance to open our eyes to see him, the risen Christ. And may our lives be transformed so, like those two disciples, our hearts may burn, our eyes may see, so that we may open our mouths and bear witness to the reality and truth of our experience of the risen Christ. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Well, today's Easter lesson is all about seeing Jesus in our lives and in our world today. And so we have asked several of our youth to share with us ways that they have seen Jesus alive and at work in their world and in their lives.
Places I've seen God recently is our new puppy, Samson. We got a new St. Bernard. The wonderful weather we've been having, as well as the garbage people who risk their life every day for us.
I see God in card games I play with my family because I pay more attention now to family time because I'm kind of stuck with them.
I saw God this week in the scavenger hunt that somebody made in our neighborhood because it was very fun and happy.
I've seen God recently when he is acting through others, like when local restaurants bring food to the local hospitals for the doctors and nurses that are working very long hours, and when the community is reaching out to our elders to offer to run errands for them.
Recently, I've seen God all around me, but especially the healthcare workers who are going on the front line in helping those who have the coronavirus.
One way I've seen God in recent times is people donating medical masks and other medical supplies to nursing homes and hospitals. Another way is car manufacturers switching what they're making to masks and respirators. That is how I've seen God in recent times.
How shall we respond to the Easter message? Well, I encourage you to bring your hope, bring your love, and above all, bring your life and offer yourself to Christ and to serving others. Let us pray. Risen Christ, bring resurrection hope to others through the gift of ourselves and our offerings. May they become signs of new life and symbols of hope for a hurting world, a world yearning for the life-giving power of your saving love. Amen. You know, although we are not gathering face-to-face in groups at church, we are offering several online ministries. And so I encourage you to turn into Facebook on our website at noon, Tuesday through Friday each week. You know, on Tuesday and Thursday, music director Scott Stevenson offers piano improvisations of hymns. And on Wednesdays and Fridays, we pastors are taking turns offering uplifting devotionals. We invite you to join us.
Find me, the glory, real.
So go now in peace with resurrection joy, knowing that from darkness and despair, we find hope and joy. From doubt and betrayal, we find trust and faith. From suffering and death, we find healing and life. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Amen.